Opinions expressed in this program are those of the program's host and guests, and not necessarily those of WSTU management, staff, or sponsors. WSTU does not endorse any products mentioned. Any reproduction or retransmission of this broadcast is strictly prohibited without written consent of WSTU. It's now time for Leadership in Business, brought to you by Jon Campion of European Kitchen and Bath. Call in with questions and comments, 220-9788-220-WSTU. And now, here's your host.
Good evening, good afternoon, Martin County, Stewart, Treasure Coast. Hi, this is Jon Campion.
Yes, it is.
Your host for Leadership in Business with my happy sidekick, the world famous Big Frank Mazzapelle. And we are pleased to have as our guest today the advertising lady extraordinaire Gail Goldie from iCare Magazine. Welcome, Gail.
Thank you, John. It's a pleasure to be here.
Well, thanks for coming into the, we got to make a name for this place, like the Army Pit or the yes. Or the cage or
the
Idea Den.
Yeah. The Idea Den. Oh,
God, see, she's advertising all the way. Wow.
Yeah,
I flunked that class. Anyways, we're really great. It's great to have you here, Gail. And we're going to talk with Gail about, you know, not only what she's done in her career in the area. She's, you know, she ought to get the Golden Gail Award. I think you already got it. But, you know, what's great about her is she almost laughs at everything I say. So
some of the things you say are pretty funny.
Well, sometimes.
Yeah, that makes it easy.
You can never ask me what I said because I can't remember. It was so funny I would start laughing. But thanks for tuning in with us.
Yeah.
And I always wonder what kind of stuff you have for being the leadoff guy, Frank. You always, I put you on the spot. We can always come back to you if you clear that.
One of the things that, you know, I want our listeners to be aware of is they can find you at europeansync.com. You have an excellent website.
Thank you, Frank.
And we don't mention that enough.
Yeah, you're right. I agree. Yeah. And we're talking about it a lot right now because of the functionality of our website, Gail, is we have a thing on it. It's called the wish list. And so people can go to europeansync.com. And there's a way that they can sign up for the wish list, which is my database. And so when they sign up for that, they are, and they log in, they can make selections of product and from any of our products, and they can actually build their own order. And for us to review with them at this point at the juncture, we're not set up exactly where we could put it online, which I said to my wife, Dee Dee, said to me the other day, she goes, did I hear you tell somebody that we could be online by the end, with the e-commerce by the end of the year? And I said, I did say that. She goes, how could you say that? I said, I don't know.
Very carefully.
Yeah. I was hoping you weren't listening. I didn't know you were outside. But so that's, you know, so the really cool thing about that, for those of you who haven't been in the store, you can go online. You can sign up for the wish list. Uh-oh, is that our wish list, Charlie, you think?
I don't know. Let's find out. You're on our newsmaker line. Go ahead, caller.
Hello, it's Charlie, your friend.
Hello, Newman.
Hello.
Can we still call you Palm City Charlie?
Sure.
Yeah, you can call me Palm City Charlie. Don't call me late for dinner.
There you go.
I just wanted to say, John, that you better check out when you have that whistler on your website. I don't know if you're not old enough, there's an old-time radio show called The Whistler.
Whistler.
Okay, well, this is called The Wish List. I'm sorry, I slurred.
Oh, the wish list. Okay.
I slurred my
words.
You're slurring
your words. You know, it's after five.
I have to have my radio voice.
Have a little potty, you know? Who knows? Okay, well, I'm glad you're not calling it The Whistler, because that's an old-time radio show. It's really cool.
Yes.
Wow. I'm glad I'm not as old as you.
you can get it on classic radio.
All right. Whistler,
and you have very quiet neighbors. You should mention that on your website.
Yeah, Okay. That's true. Mm-hmm.
All right, and I'll get off because I love hearing about advertising and you have an advertising woman.
We have Gail, the Golden Goldie here. Yes. She is
the Golden Goldie.
She knows what to do. So
she's okay. Well, I'm going to listen and learn.
Okay. You know? All right.
My ears will be pinned back and open.
Okay. Perfect.
Okay.
As they should be.
All right. Thanks. All right. All right. Bye-bye. All right. Excellent.
That's one good of our call. Regulars. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Charlie's good. He's always stirring things up.
Yeah.
So Gail, let's talk to you.
Okay. Because,
you know, we can talk to ourselves anytime. And in all seriousness, you know, one of the things that I think is cool is you worked with my mom 20 plus years ago. So you were one of the fortunate people that met Peggy and got to know her, and she advertised with you. I think you were you with the newspaper?
I was with the Palm Beach Post.
Palm Beach Post. Oh, she loved the Palm Beach Post.
Yeah.
Yeah, she did. And so good job.
It's always a pleasure to go and see Peggy. She was such an enjoyable person to work with.
No, thank you. Yeah. Thank you. And, you know, it's ironic when I came here 20 years ago, how much, you know, she was, you know, it's like I am, she's the advertising lady. And, I used to go, wow. So how much are we spending on Yellow Pages? $25,000, you know, that's nothing compared to some other people, but, right. You know, and then how we now compare that to social media and what do we spend on that.
Right.
And versus, you know, how do you know what you're doing? So that top of the mind advertising TOMA, mm-hmm. as I learned to get it when we did that in Stewart News and, mm-hmm. and Peggy always, had ads with, you in the Palm Beach Post. Mm-hmm. So, but anyways, as Gail's moved around in the, she's gone where she's supposed to go.
Yes.
And, I think I met you probably about 12, 15 years ago.
Yeah, I would say that's probably about right.
Yeah. So I'm going, all right, what is this stuff? What do I got to do? Cause back then we had a lot of advertising people calling on us. You know, we had a couple people from the newspapers and the magazines
and the Yellow Pages.
And it was
thankfully,
just like,
those people seem to have gone by way of the Etsy.
Mm-hmm. And then now you have people that will call you up and say, oh, hey, I saw your website and I can help you get, many, many contacts. You know, so now it's the other side of it is right. Like, okay, who's the best at, you know, telling me what I need to hear. So, you know, when I went to my advertising thing, I mean, in my second year of doing Google Analytics, you know, we're looking at it going, has it really added that much? Cause I was hoping it would, but in analyzing the numbers, we're seeing where things are. You know, where it goes up here, it goes up there. And when it goes down here, it goes down here. And so at the end of the year, the volume is about what we expected. And it wasn't much different than the year before. Mm-hmm. But as long as we're making money and paying our bills and taking care of our employees and doing all that, that's my biggest.
Right.
That's my biggest concern is I don't want to ever say, sorry, I can't pay you this week. Here, take a filter. It's great. I still buy you lunch on Friday, you know, but, so tell me how, in your mind, the advertising business has changed in the last, well, let's say the last 10, 15 years, you know, mm-hmm. when the change started happening with websites and all that, what were you thinking? You were going, well, was something that you, cause you know, you're one of those, you're like one of those voyagers out there who's always thinking what's going to happen, what's coming mm-hmm, next.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I always have felt that there's definitely a print, you know, a place for print in advertising. People have got to realize when they have their business that they have to take a multi-pronged approach to advertising their business. And that can be with the internet, you know, with your website, with print. You know, you can rotate that, you know, you have your budget, that's most important. And one of the things that I want to tell you that hasn't changed much over the many years John.
Yep.
Is John Wanamaker. Do you know who John Wanamaker was? He had a department store chain in Philadelphia called Wanamaker's.
Wanamaker's.
It was a department store. And actually, I used to call on that when I lived up in that area, and it wasn't for advertising. I was in the gift industry, and I worked with the department stores. I was the sales representative for A&S, Wanamaker, Strawbridge and Clothier, and many, many department stores. But John Wanamaker said, the problem with advertising is 50% of my dollars are lost. I don't know what 50.
Yeah.
So, yeah. that hasn't changed yet today. I mean, people still feel that way. I mean, you talk to them about their advertising dollars and they'll scratch their head and say, gee, I don't know what's effective. Well, you do have to track what's effective, but the most important thing that I can tell you is that you must have your name out there. And John, you talked about your website and putting on a wish list on your website. I think that's a great idea. And I would like to make a suggestion on that wish list. If you are putting a wish list on there, you should do something like where a relative can go on, like I could pick out my beautiful faucets for the kitchen. And, you know, the children are always saying to you, know, what do you want for your birthday? What do you want for Christmas? What do you want? So if you have it accessible to the people who view it, they can say, well, go to European Kitchen and Bath. I'm on the wish. I look at my wish list.
Yeah.
And they can make contributions to the purchase that they'd like to get for their mother or father or whatever, you know.
Yeah. Or maybe a young couple getting married.
Yes.
They can create the wish list and the family can get them.
They just get a basic Toto and they get a washlet bidet seat for the parents.
There you go. There you go.
Yeah.
Right,
but, right. You know, they have those, that's, you know, interesting. You know, so that might be something that you could do for your, to encourage people to come back to your website, you know, see how much money they've got toward their purchase of what they liked, what they picked,
right.
You know?
Right.
So,
well, that's certainly something that I had not thought about. And, you know, that's why I called you down here today.
See, yeah, we learn on the fly.
Yeah. Get Goldie down here. We need her.
Well, you've been successful for all these years. European Kitchen and Bath has been the number one out there, and you're going to continue with that. And you certainly do a lot of the things right. I see you advertise, and I love your billboard out front of your store there with always a cute little laugh or, you know, something to make you smile.
That's our highlight.
Yeah.
I had to call FDOT today because they're doing all this work they're getting ready to do on Canner and Mott, and they have a big sign in front of my store, right in front of my sign.
Perfect.
Yeah. So I'm on this, email list I've been on for forever, and I got to call the girl who's in charge of community development or whatever.
Yeah.
And I told her who I was and what the deal, and she goes, send it to, I'll give you an answer tomorrow. So, you know, but I mean, it is a big sign, it blocks our, and it blocks that way. If it was this way, forget it, who cares? But anyways,
well, they did the same thing to Lola's, you know, when they were they put that signage, flashing billboard sign, because they're doing the work at the Sailfish Circle at the railroad track to redirect traffic to let people know that it's closed. Great, except for Lola's no longer had any signage available to the people coming, you know, over the Roosevelt Bridge.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, not too happy. But the good news is it only lasted a week or so.
Well, the good news is your wife knows where it is. Yes. So
my wife knows how to find Lola's.
That's right. So, so with that, let's just say, okay, so 10 years ago when social media, I mean, it's Florida time. I have a really hard time pinpointing a year or something.
Yeah.
COVID just messed everything up. For me, but
Florida time, you almost have to multiply times three.
You know, we have the customer comes in the store and we say, how many years ago did you buy this? And they go, I think it was 4. And we 12. Find out it was 10 or 12 you know, so it's really tough to pinpoint for me. I mean, you're relocated from Philly and I'm relocated from Nashville. You're relocated from Detroit, which was a good move.
It's a good place to be from.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. It's a good place to be from. But, you know, with you know, you see the different things that go on, but in the end, like you say, you got to be out there. I had somebody make a comment to me the other day. He goes, "Man, you're everywhere." And I was like, I was really glad to hear that. It kind of warmed my soul.
Shows that your advertising works.
I said, "Were you?" I, as long as they weren't reading the wall inside the bathroom at the pool. Jon Campion is no. In all seriousness, you know me, I'm serious all the time.
All the time.
All the time,
without a doubt.
But you know, it's how can I? You want to be out there. You want to. You know, we see people that are in some of our business groups who. You know, they're up. I was on that billboard for 10 years there.
Well, you're out there for a good reason. The good reason is that you're an expert in that field. And that is what you need to continue to promote. And that's what you're known for. Mm-hmm. And I always tell people, you know, when you have an opportunity to, whether it be in print, to write a column, give people information, something that they can remember that, you know, I know it's a silly thing, and I know I'm going to get a big story out of you on this, but the Toto toilet, okay?
It was the 1st of September, 2000.
So the Toto toilet. Someone's looking to buy a toilet. The point of difference between a Toto toilet and another brand, you know what it is. You know the
it's $400. No, but you're right.
But why it's worth $400 more? What's the difference? You know.
Yeah, I had to use one of my nemesis's toilets this morning, and I couldn't decide whether I just wanted to miss it, teach him a lesson,
learn him.
But I didn't do it. You're right, and people who you got a great point, because some people don't know what. Never heard of Toto.
Right.
But people who've had a Toto or been around me know what a Toto is because I speak Toto.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And, we have customers, one of the things that Toto is it's an expensive product. Mm-hmm. It's made, Toto is made in 80 countries. Okay. They're the world's largest, plumbing manufacturer, but they, our popular ones are made in Atlanta or Mexico. And all three of these popular ones were all made in USA till recently. They have to move around their production to meet their demands. But the quality of the China and the performance of the product and all that. And in the end, people who come into the story now, I'm always worried that we've.
I like the way he begins it in the end.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, cool.
Well, it's, play on words.
Yeah, okay, inside joke. Okay.
But I got to tell you, it's, I can't speak anymore. No, it's, when people come in and they've had Toto, they want Toto. They don't care what it costs.
It's the point of difference. And that's, once that's pointed out, people understand the difference.
Why?
Yeah. Most people are probably more than most are uneducated on the value and the difference between the two different types of toilets or whatever. And it's the same thing with everything else that you sell, your faucets, the way that they're made, the quality of the materials that go into that, how they will last for years and years and not deteriorate and, and the importance, that's what you have to do is to educate people and they'll remember that, I remember I read that about Toto and that's why it costs a little more, so.
We have another caller in the newsmaker line. Go ahead, caller.
I couldn't help myself.
Oh, okay.
I was in print advertising for 26 years. So anyway, picture this, the Royal Flush. Huh? Toto, right? Quarter-page dessert. Do standby in the Palm Beach Post. Full page, right? Every once in a while, they need that page, right?
Yeah.
Young lady.
Yes, they have remnants.
Yeah. I work for the Harper Current and the Stewart News.
Oh, okay.
I never had the pleasure to call on John.
Oh.
right. You know, it's.
Well, I'm going to get off the phone because I'm having too much fun.
All right.
And I'm enjoying your show. Very interesting.
All right. Calm down, Charlie. It's great.
I know. Royal flush. Go ahead.
Yeah, I get it. Thanks, get buddy.
All right.
Hey, and Charlie, if you're out there and you come up with slogans, I have 5 lines on the marquee.
Oh, perfect.
And it has to be 17 spaces. So, I mean,
okay.
If you have a space, 17 characters.
Right.
That's what you know, you can think up the greatest things, but you know, hey, the Royal Flush, we've done it, but that's okay. You know, I can put on there, even Palm City Charlie can't clog a Toto.
Yeah.
How's that?
I like it.
Yeah. I've got a couple business people that have approved that I could put that up there regarding them.
Nice.
I just have to spell their name right this time.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. So, you know,
good,
but you know, Gail, I guess one of the things I wanted to kind of bring along here, because we can get off on so many tangents, it's great, is that when we are in a small community, we're in a small community, and you know, it's kind of like the nonprofits, the advertising mechanisms out there or channels are huge, you know. Mm-hmm. Like iCare has, you know, four things, and you start getting into some of this Ocean Media stuff. Mm-hmm. Which I say stuff, you know, I mean, that product works for some and doesn't work for others. And
well, that's true, John, because you know, there's coupon magazines that are coupon. There's coupon people, you know, there's a lot of businesses that advertise in the coupon magazines. And I've talked to several of the people who've advertised in the coupon magazines, and they tell me that, you know, they get the same customers over and over. They'll only shop there if they have the coupon. Mm-hmm. So sometimes you create, you know, you create a certain type of customer,
right,
that, you know, by being into that, you know, where when you're in a coupon magazine, I might make a suggestion that, you know, if you're going to run a coupon, you make sure that you have an expiration date on it and that, you know, it can
only have to create some immediacy.
Yes. Also. But you want to make sure that they're just not coming in because there's a coupon.
Right. Know, so. Right. You know, yeah. Years ago tried the coupon, then we just determined that one of those avenues that I just mentioned that you're alluding to, it doesn't work for our business. Mm-hmm. You know, we're not a coupon.
Right.
You want to give them a reason to come. And, you know, if you can offer them.
The reason to come in your business is that someone is coming there for your expertise and your knowledge on what is the best product for them.
Yeah.
When they walk through that door and they tell you they're looking for a specific faucet for the bathroom, you take them, or you have your salesman take them and show them the options that they have and explain exactly what would fit their need.
You have to stand back or it'll squirt you and then make sure. No, that's
stand
great.
Back,
no,
this could get ugly. Yeah.
I had somebody walk in today with her husband, and somebody was helping them, and our kitchen department is located towards the rear of the store. And I heard this lady say to her husband, I hope you're listening, actually. It was very cool. She goes, "What, don't they make two stainless steel double bowl sinks anymore?" And of course, we have a lot of single bowl sinks on display because that's what the trend is right mm-hmm. now. But I ended up putting in 2 or 3 sets of double bowls. And I said, "What are you talking about? I come popping out of my office, which is very dangerous. You never know what I'm going to say. I'm either going to say something John like, which is good, or something that's like my dad, you know, you sound just like Dick." Yeah. So I can't help it. But anyways, I showed her the sinks and she's like, "Oh, that's, I'm glad I have a single bowl. I don't like it, but you know, double bowls." Mm-hmm. I mean, there was a period of time we could not believe the amount of people asking for single bowl sinks. Mm-hmm. And what do you have at home?
What do I have? Single.
Yeah. And mm-hmm. how long have you had that?
I guess.
A long time.
Yeah.
You like that. You don't need the double bowl.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have a problem when you wash your dishes. Where do you put them?
No, I put them right in the strainer.
Okay.
Yeah.
That came with the sink, right? You can't remember back that far.
No, I just put the dishes in the sink, wash the dishes off, put them in the strainer.
Yeah. Okay, right.
It's on the countertop, okay. right next to the sink.
Okay. Right? Yeah, yeah. Some manufacturers have them.
Old school. Yeah.
That's old school stuff. That's a bed and beyond. Bed and ground. It's okay. You've got it figured out.
Yeah.
You have your system. And we have ours. We're two bowl people.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we work on, you know, washing this one, rinsing this one, drip dry in there, and you're set to go.
The problem I have is that it seems to me that I must cook with large pots and pans, because I did have a two bowl at one point in time when we lived in a different home. And
you struggle.
Right. Yes. I could not fit. Yeah, it didn't work.
Right.
Yeah.
So you know what they did for you on that? They made a low divide in the middle, because on a two bowl, how much water would you really put into a bowl when you're washing your dishes? You're not going to fill it up to three to half or three. Are you? Are you, Jill? Jill, I love you. You're my sister. And when you come over and help do dishes after we have a nice meal, take a seat. You know, water gets a little murky if you don't kind of change it out. But
I'm a rinse and load.
Yeah, there you go.
So there. Yeah. I rinse it all and put it in the dishwasher.
That a babe.
Okay.
All right.
So there we go.
That's perfect.
All right. All right. Trained well.
All right.
What are you going to do now, Frank? All You're right. pressing buttons like a break or something?
I am. It's that mystical, magical time once again.
Leadership and business. We're taking a break. We'll be back in minuscule seconds, right? It seems like it.
We'll be back in a moment. So all right. Stick with us.
Thanks a lot, Frank.
And now here's the laughing report of the past, present.
Rowan and Martin's laughing. Yeah.
Penelope Parkenfarker from Peoria, who paints pink hockey pucks.
That's right.
I heard that. I was at a Ronan Martin show in Las Vegas with my family when I was in like fourth or sixth grade. I just know my mom dressed me like a little boy. I had little white knee socks right up below my knees and my round shoes. And my sister, when I went to pointed shoes and short socks, that was it for her. Her little baby brother, John John, was history.
All grown up.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah.
Got rid of your round shoes and your thanks. You know, yeah, your little, dorky brother.
Nice.
That's great.
Yeah. I like to always.
At first, I thought that was Hello, Dolly.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I wanted to get a little snippet from Goldie Hawn. The Goldie connection.
Goldie there. Gold.
Yeah. But
anyways, we got Goldie Hawn.
We got our own Goldie here.
That's
right. Mm-hmm. But, anyways, okay.
Well, so, Are you ready to discuss some more stuff about our little town and what's going on here? You've been here since, what'd you say? Did you say 90s? No.
We bought a home here in 88.
88.
And we moved down permanently in 99.
We have a microphone. It's okay to use it.
I didn't know we were on.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Those commercials are short and sweet.
So laid back in here. I mean, it's like.
We are casual.
I know. So. Really, you get me my robes, please. My slippers.
Oh yeah. Yeah, that'd be right.
Right. Mm. Yeah. A little fireside chat.
And a pipe. You gotta have a pipe.
Yeah. Got my own. But you know, so you think about so when did you hop back into advertising right away? When you came down here?
Oh, when I came down here in 99, when we decided to be down here permanently.
Okay, so 88.
88 to 99 was just part-time. We were here for long weekends and vacation and such. And
back when we were young.
When I think back to my husband and I buying our place down here in 88, and we were in our late 30s, it's just, how fortunate we were.
Yeah.
How very fortunate we were, because we picked Martin County. We traveled from Fort Pierce. We came down and started in Fort Pierce, from Fort Pierce to Port St. Lucie to Stewart to Hobe Sound, all the way down to Boca, looking for a place. And we decided that after we were in Boca, that was our last stop. And then my husband looked at me and said to me, "We're going back to Martin County and we're going to buy that townhouse that we saw." And that's what we did. So, and that was in 88.
You know, I don't know if you know this, but that's what happened with my parents. They were living in Boca at Boca West.
Mm-hmm, that's it.
And my dad traveled so much, but he was like Archie Bunker and didn't quite fit in down there. And my mom said, "Well, let's go up to Martin County." And that's when they went into Harbor Ridge. Mm-hmm. And just, how can you turn that down?
Yeah.
So that's how they ended up here. Yeah. And they were, 30 plus years.
Yeah.
Just hanging out.
Yeah.
We come down and visit them. I go, "Oh, it's a pretty nice place. And I'll never live here. I don't want," next thing I know, I'm on my 20th year.
It happens.
Yeah. But, I don't know. It's really interesting after all the years up north and then coming down here and really understanding, how busy Florida is and always has been. I mean, my companies, Frank's heard stories a million times on, I was for 15 years prior to coming here, I sold McDonald's their kitchens in Mid-Atlantic and some far and away places in Alabama, Tennessee. And that was really fun. But I'd always see my counterpart who was in Florida. He was always doing about three times the jobs I was doing in Norfolk. And, and then realizing that if back then 1,000 people a day were coming in and now it's 5,000, and it's crazy.
Yes.
But it's a different thing. And a lot of people don't understand it. They're, wherever they're from, it's things they're not used to. Or they had their own impression of it, or they liked it and they decided to come here,
Exactly.
Now is the worst time to come here because it's just so cold. and you know, I'm shoveling sunshine every day into my pool, trying to keep that at about 84 degrees.
Well, what was the hardest thing for you to get used to when you moved to Florida?
Well, the first week I lived with my parents, and soon I found a condo. I think the hardest part was when I, you know, I knew that we had bought the business and it was going to just be me involved. And of course my wife Dee Dee is plugged in now. And it was when the first week that I went to work, you know, I would get there early. We open at 9 and my staff would get there on Florida time. And I go, you know, I'm paying you guys to be parked in traffic coming over the guiding bridge, you know. And so I'd come in there some mornings and I go, what the heck have I done? So it was adjusting to the fact that the way I looked at it before I came here is a customer is a customer. So I, whether it's a customer of mine, a McDonald's customer, or it's a customer of mine who's, you know, in my business. And that was the hardest thing for me to kind of just put into perspective, because it was a little different.
Yeah.
But in the end, the satisfaction was there. And I think that was the biggest part. And then, of course, you know, I hadn't been around my parents since high school. And so coming down here and living around them, you know, I wanted my two boys, who are now in their mid-30s, early-30s, to have an experience with their grandma and grandpa.
That's nice.
And they did.
Yes.
Which was great. Yeah. You know, and to this day, you know, we laugh about the nicknames they were called, and how my, you know, my dad aggravated them and my mom loved them. And anyway, so that was, I guess, the good, the bad, and the ugly. It was tough. You know, the other thing too, I should say, for 15 plus years, it was a good thing prior. I lived in Richmond for like 18 years. That's where I moved from, down to Nashville. And in Richmond, I had friends, because I had a manufacturer's rep job for a while, so I could screw off a lot. And then I never really had a real job there. I always worked out of my home, and I was used to that. But then, you know, coming to a different place. And then, for example, when I lived in Nashville, my friends were maybe neighbors on a weekend with a little get together or something. I was from Monday through Friday, I was in a plane going somewhere for 7 years.
Yeah, I did that too. So
it's no fun. Yeah, no. Especially
well,
now.
It depends on the industry you're in. I mean, I was in a woman's industry, you know, in the greeting card and gift wraps. So, you know, and gift and all that kind of stuff. So every day that I was out there, it was like I was out shopping.
You know? Yeah. Every day was Christmas.
Yeah, right. But I'll tell you, the hardest, the transition coming from the New York area, Philadelphia area, and being down here into Florida, that was a very, very difficult for me as far as fitting into the Florida mindset. And you talked about it, you know, I coming from the Northeast and being in sales, you know, there was no time to sit back and wait,
right.
You know, it was get in there, make your presentation, close the sale, you know, close the sale.
And where am I going the next day?
Right. You know, and down here, I mean, I remember standing in line at Publix and I'm thinking to myself, do these people ever move? You know, I mean, it was, the line was like, you know, so leisurely, you know,
they start writing their check when they get up, they pull it out.
Yeah,
I get it.
And I just wasn't used to that. But I have to say that, you know, I'm glad now that, you know, I've learned to slow down a little bit.
It took me 20 years not to tailgate, which made Dee Dee real happy. And the other part was, I don't honk at people anymore. You know, to move, like when the light turns red. Because I say if they honk at you, they're from New York. They're in a hurry.
Yeah.
Well, you shouldn't be in a hurry when you're in Florida. And I remind myself, I'm not in a hurry. I don't care.
Yeah.
When I get there, I get there. Am I going to be? Maybe I'll be late for the radio today and really bug Frank. So he doesn't have to call me when I'm in the parking lot trying to get out of my car.
Well, I think, too, it depends on the you know, like the industry. I mean, I've been in an industry where it's always a deadline. There's always a deadline.
Yeah.
And that's a little bit different than a lot of other types of jobs.
Why don't we take another little break? You know, sir. It's funny you say that, because when I did this last ad for eye care, I actually kind of came through. I was only a week late getting the picture in, and you know, anyways, you did a good job on that. Wow. You hit me just right. You hit me behind the eyes just right, Gail. Like you know how to do.
Well, we're gonna toss it to Rocky and Bullwinkle. See
okay.
what they got.
All right. Nothing up the sleeve.
And now,
hey Rocky, watch me pull a rabbit out of my hat.
Again.
Nothing up my sleeve. Frisco.
We don't have any fun here.
Every morning at the mine, you could see him arrive. He stood 6'6" and weighed 245, kind of broad at the shoulder and narrow at the hip. And
everybody has got to turn the stereo off at home.
Yeah,
I have very sensitive hearing.
Some of that stuff, you just got to crank up the volume to really appreciate
That's right.
the nuance.
That's right.
Yeah, okay.
Now, we did have the discussion, by the way, on the Big John, is that they used to make the Big John,
mm-hmm.
and the guy went out of business. It wasn't very profitable. There weren't that many big
right.
Freds and Jims as they thought. So they shrunk it back down to normal size.
Yeah, it's unfortunate, but it makes sense.
It
yeah.
is. I mean, you know, there's certain ways for right. people out there who are handicapped or whatever to get their dignity back
right.
when it comes to going to the bathroom. Now, you know, would you rather be really annoyed every time you got to go in there? Or would you rather, you know, spend a little money up front? You have something there like these bidet washlet mm-hmm. seats that mm-hmm. are, I'm not, you know, I mean, it's something that we're selling a lot of because
right.
Toto has a really great promoting job on mm-hmm. it with literature. And, you know, they've done a great job promoting it in the U.S. The first half of the year. And, you know, where we used to not, we'd sell maybe 3 or 4 a month, we were selling at least that many a week.
Hmm.
And, you know, that's at $1,000 a clip.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then we even went to the higher units that are even fancier. And, you know, so we, you know, we have, you walk into the store now, Frank, you remember you got that toilet seat that comes
oh, yeah.
up and goes
yeah,
down.
So
like,
at you. Yeah.
Yeah. He yeah. says, hey, Frank, you're here. Hey, okay, buddy. Thanks for coming.
I love it.
I just got to make sure that when the little kids are in there, the parents are keeping an eye on them.
Yeah.
I don't need a Johnny Knoxville thing happening.
Oh, my God.
You know, put a newspaper on the thing and see what happens. Or put a Curious George book. You know, you'll be in big trouble. Hey, Curious George books are right over here, kids. Just throw them in the tub. So
yeah, boy, the showroom, you added some nice tubs.
Well, we already sold three out of there, and we really don't like to sell them. We like to display them right. So that people go, oh, because everybody coming in, I'm sorry, Gail, I'm not ignoring. The people come in and they go, I've been online and I can't tell the quality of,
yeah.
And well, that's why we have them. And we mm-hmm. have, you know, four or five different manufacturers, and that's what we want to sell.
Yeah.
And, you know, we've gotten through the supply chain
that's
issue.
What I was going to say, that's what my question was going to be. How yeah. are you doing with inventory?
And we're, you know, one of the cool products that we have that really came through this week for us was the, you know, you sell alcove tubs, you know, that your regular tub size. Mm-hmm. And I stock 30 by 60s with a tile flange around them in white. Six of, you know, I try to keep, well, we've been selling more left than right. But Vero called down today needing one. And they were told like 6 or 8 weeks at the mm-hmm. factory. And my purchasing agent goes, oh, well, we have five of them down here. And we just stack them up like cordwood and pull them out and sell them. Hmm. So, and they're a really great price and it's a really excellent quality. So, you know, yeah. I mean, there's big things like that you wouldn't think.
Yeah.
And we just tell people, if you see something in here and you want to ask, just ask. Don't, we're not hiding anything. We're right. not, you know, we're exposing things. So, yeah. So anyways, trying to keep ahead of the game. So the big thing that I'm doing this year now, Gail, is I did the Google Analytics for the past year.
Mm-hmm.
And so now I'm going into my second year of deciding, okay, is this worth it? Or am I still getting the same business for the same amount of work? Because the whole philosophy that we call the showroom planning, we call it the earn more, do less. So, you know, if we can make our jobs easier and do the throughput mm-hmm. and get it right and get pricing back to people in a timely manner. And so that's the big thing we're, you know, that we're aiming for on these, on that wish list. And, you know, it's great when we can go in there and it has all our items. Now, everything comes out at MSRP, you know, list price, mm-hmm. but, you know, it changes so often. You can't put a net or a selling discounted mm-hmm. price in there. You mm-hmm. just can't. I mean, some of the big boys can, cause they got fancy pants websites and they, you know, they spend millions.
They may also block out a
well, and,
purchase.
And I don't target. This is one of the cool things. I don't go after, you know, the bigger boys, like, you know, obviously Amazon or Ferguson mm-hmm. or as I call them, Ferguson. But, you know, we try to make sure that, like, for example, each store, my website goes out 25 mile radius.
Uh-huh.
And I have nice zip codes in there,
mm-hmm.
which I got from one of your competitors. They left their thing in my office and I got all the zip codes listed from here up to Vero to pick the good neighborhoods
mm-hmm.
and I need to refine that because I don't understand it, but mm-hmm. but you know, that type of thing.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we're working on that and hoping that will bring us some good rewards.
Well, I think you've done the right thing. You know, you're tracking it for a year and the Google Analytics are very good to use and to dissect and to find out exactly.
You can spend days yes. and days dissecting yes. that stuff.
And you can really drill down, and that's mm-hmm. what's exciting when, you know, a specific yeah. target market that you're looking for, age, income, you know, all of that stuff is easily identifiable. And there's also mailing lists that you can purchase, yeah. but you know, you can, I know when I was with Florida Healthcare News and we were looking for target markets, I mean, I could tell them, you know what, I want a list of everybody in area code, zip code 34994 that has blue eyes and is over 50 years old. I mean, they can do that. They can pull that out for you. You know, you can segment for income, all different things.
I don't trust people with brown eyes.
I said blue eyes.
I know what you said. I'm looking at Frank going, he's got brown eyes. I can pick on him again.
Mine are Hazel.
Yes,
Hazel.
Yeah.
They're really
and
cool.
Frank and I share the same birthday and the same color eyes because mine are Hazel as well. So.
Wow.
Yeah. We're both August 5th.
I wonder how many people born on that. I have to look. No, Sam is blue. He was born August 8th. So it must be the people born before him.
Mm-hmm.
No, that's cool. I was wondering, I was going, those aren't really brown. So Hazel.
Yeah.
Forgot about Hazel.
Yeah.
It's good. That's why you're so cute, Frank.
Yeah, that's it. That was it.
Doesn't he look like he gets younger? I mean, he's not getting any older from when you met him, is he?
No, not a day older.
And he's, I've known him. Yeah. I've known him since he was this tall?
Still that.
Yeah, that's great. No, that's great.
Well, look, he doesn't have a gray hair on his head.
No.
No. Pretty good for 40.
I don't have a hair on my head. I got 3 or 4 bullet holes from the dermatologist freezing my things. Yeah. You know what I found out today? I did not know this, but, I was telling my wife that I don't know why they have to, do the freeze thing to my head. And she goes, well, that stuff is from your previous years from being in the sun. It's coming up and out. I said, I didn't know.
It's like 30 years ago. The exposure. Yeah.
She's going, you played a lot of golf. And I said, yeah, I did. And so anyways, it's probably why I lost my beautiful hair.
Well, you wore a hat, didn't you?
All the time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, sweated those follicles right out. It's like my daddy.
Couldn't be you pulled those hairs out when you were playing golf.
No. I did have a hair pulling incident. I did have a hair pulling incident on my bus one time in 10th or 11th grade.
Ah.
There was my neighbor across the street, Brian, was pretty abusive to people.
Ah.
He liked to pick on them. Well, there was a very poor family. These kids, you think they would eat, they were eating their dogs for, it was just really sad. Aww. Well, one day Brian was sitting, he's sitting behind me or something. And he was reaching over me and hitting this girl on the head with his books. And he kept doing it. And she reached out and thought it was me. And she started yanking my hair out the bus. And so I went home and kicked a box of fortified oak flakes across the kitchen. Right past my mother. Says, what's the matter with you? I can't play Brian. And I had this big bald spot on my head.
Oh, my God.
So that's the way we end the story.
And yes.
Gail, you can come back anytime you want.
Well, thank you.
You have so much in there. And
pearls of wisdom.
I was talking too much today, I will admit.
Oh, it's a pleasure to be here. And it's always a pleasure to speak to you and to see Frank. And
we want to make sure that you enjoyed it and had fun and laughed a couple times. Oh, yeah. I saw you laughing over there. But thanks, Frank. Uh-huh. Good job as always. Everybody, we'll see you next week.
Right here.
And I can't tell you who my special guest is because they're so special.
Same time, same channel.
That's it. We're going to be here.
Me too.
Thanks. And thank you, Gail Goldie. And Gail, can we get a number where people can reach you?
772-233-7332.
And you'll see her magazine all around town. Yep. I Care Community.
I Care Community.
All right. Bye.
It's got a...
a pleasure. It was enjoyable, very much.